go ahead and show you how the entire system works together first, and then I'll come back and show you some a little more detail on some of the components. So first of all, we'll start off with the solar panels. The solar panels is what determines your total system input wattage. We're going with 400 watt Trina solar panels, total of 16. So you just multiply 400 by 16, you get 6,400 watts. So that'll be the total watts coming into the house. I'm going to be dividing those up into two arrays. There's going to be two in series. And so in series means that these two are connected like this. So each of the arrays will be in two in series, four in parallel. I'm just kind of drawing out how they'll be wired together. And I'll come back in a little bit and explain how to calculate the voltages and amperages. There again, I'm not a professional system designer, and so basically don't quote me on any of this. But I'll offer you what I know. We've lined up our solar panels here and in two separate arrays, and then we're going to bring our solar panels into our MPPT controllers. And so when that raw power is coming in and it's going into your controllers, so this controller is taking that wattage, is taking the electricity that's coming in from your solar panels, which is going to vary constantly. It's going to vary, you know, depending on the time of day and the amount of shade and all. There's a ton of factors, you know, how clean they are. And so the amount of output that your solar panels are generating is constantly changing. And so all that comes into your controller, and your controller takes care of regulating all that power, gets it ready to go to the next stage of the system. I chose to split my system into two parts just based on the size. It's a fairly large system. It's hard to find a controller that will handle 6,400 watts, and so I just broke it into two and went with two controllers. That also gives me a little bit of redundancy and a little backup. If one of these controllers were to go bad, I would still have the other array, and so I would be on half power, but I would still have some power. So the loss of my MPPT controller won't totally knock me out. So I like that little bit of redundancy. They're going to come out of your controller, and then we're going to join them up, and they're both going to come into a DC breaker box. So you're dealing with a DC power here. Just a quick note on DC power, it's real dangerous. AC power is alternating current, and it tends to kind of kick you back. DC current is direct current, and it tends to make you lock on. So it's actually more dangerous than AC current. And we're going to be dealing with some fairly high voltages here for DC that can actually be deadly, so it's extremely dangerous. So this should be handled with great care. So we're going to bring that into a DC breaker box, and that's just so that if there's an overload in one of the systems, we have a short in one of the circuits somewhere, we start drawing high voltages, that breaker will trip and cut the power. And we can also just shut it down as we like. We're going to come out of the breaker into the BMS, which stands for Battery Management System. The battery management system tends to your battery. So your solar battery is going to be made of 16 individual batteries. We're going to be building it from 16 individual batteries to get the voltage that we need. And I'll explain a little bit more about that later, but just for right now, keep in mind that this big battery here is made up of 16 smaller batteries. And each one of those batteries has different needs as far as, you know, how fast it can take in power and discharge power. And so your battery management system optimizes each battery, each individual component of your larger battery. And so that's why you need the BMS. All right, the BMS is going to send battery power over to your battery pack, and will charge your batteries with the power that you're getting from your solar system. Out of your battery, you're going to take power, and it's going to go directly over to your split phase inverter. Now, the reason I have a split phase inverter here is because we live in the U.S., and normal household power in the U.S. is split phase. That means that it comes to us in two legs and a neutral. Each leg is 110 volts, and so you can combine those to get 220 volts. It's different from, you know, power in Europe, where it's all 220. So in a normal U.S. household, you need to have access to, you know, 110 power or 220 power, and it usually comes into the house in that split phase system, two 110 legs, and so you can either use just one of the legs and get 110 power, or you can combine the legs and get 220. It also comes in at 60 hertz. So that's why in the U.S. you're going to need a split phase converter if you want like regular household power. If you want that 110, you want to be able to use regular household appliances and also use 220 for like your washer and dryer and, you know, big power users. You're also going to want 60 hertz in the U.S. It's going to be 50 if you're in Europe, and most of the good inverters will auto-select for 50 or 60 hertz, but you need to keep an eye out on that. Also, coming into your inverter, you're going to have a generator option. So your generator is also going to come into your inverter, so that if you run out of battery or your some part of your solar system goes out, you just bring in power through the generator into your inverter, and your inverter feeds your house. Now this is a 600 or 6,000 watt inverter. It's a big inverter. It is a low frequency, pure sine wave inverter. I can go into more detail on that when I explain to you why I selected that one. But there's a benefit to those things. Anyway, you're going to come out of power with the inverter, and you're going to go over to your distribution panel. This is basically the breaker box in your house, and this is where you'll bring power out to all of your appliances in your house. So just like a regular house where you have your, you know, your breaker box in the, you know, in the garage or whatever, you'll come out of this to all of your household appliances, all your outlets for your house. So I'd like to go into a little more detail for you on how to calculate your voltages and amperages and explain a little bit about series and parallel. When you do a series connection, basically you're going to, your amps are going to stay the same, but your voltages are going to add up. So, you know, series is when you connect two together like this. These two are connected in series. And so when we connect these two together, each one of these panels puts out 41 volts. And so when we connect the two together, we get 82 volts. And the same works for when we go into parallel, we're adding them up like this. And so when we go into parallel, the voltage stays the same, but the amps add up. And so we have four in parallel, so we'll add up 9.8, which is the amperage that each one puts out. Multiply that times four, and so we get 39.2. And so that's how you figure out how you need to configure your system. My system, these MPPT controllers that I bought, have a maximum input voltage of 150 volts. And so I had to configure it in such a way that we never exceeded that. And the 41 volts is kind of the nominal voltage. It can go much higher depending on the conditions, the outdoor temperatures, a lot of factors. So this is 82, and it could go considerably higher than that. So I didn't feel good about putting any more than two in series to keep it well under that 150 maximum voltage in. Four in parallel, we're only at 39.2 amps. And we're good there too. So you're going to take your voltage and your amperage inputs that your MPPT is capable of, and, you know, kind of use that to figure out how to configure your solar panel array. The same kind of thing works when you're trying to figure out how to do your batteries. So I decided to go with a 48 volt battery system. I went with the 48 volt system for a number of reasons. It's a little bit more efficient. When you get into the more powerful inverters, they require a 48 volt input. And so that's why I decided to go with the 48 volt. And so in order to achieve a 48 volt battery, I decided to go with smaller batteries that are 3.2 volt and 372 amp hour batteries. These batteries you can get pretty cheap, and you can put them together in series and they will add up. So remember, series multiplies the volts, and so that's why we went with 16 of the individual pieces and ended up with a 48 volt battery system. And with that information, you can also calculate the kilowatt hour that your battery is able to store and produce back into the house, you know, after your solar batteries, solar panels stop producing at night. And so you do a little bit more math. You multiply your 48 volts, or in this case, it's actually 51 volts, 48 volts nominal, but you'd multiply actually 51 times 372, and that's going to get you to the storage, total storage capacity of 13,800 kilowatt hours. 13.8 kilowatt hours, actually. So that's actually 13.8 kilowatt hours. So I want to give a shout out to a couple online resources that I use that really helped me out with my project and deciding what I wanted to buy. One of them was the do-it-yourself DIY solar system forum, which was fantastic and I would recommend. The other is this site right here, Purple Alien Planet. I don't know who this guy is, but he posted a link to this post on his website. And I can't remember if I saw it on Reddit or if I saw it on the DIY solar forum, but anyway, he was building a system similar to what I wanted to build, and he had a nice little write-up, and he was really helpful. It was a great little write-up. It kind of inspired me to build a similar system and use some similar components. And so check this guy out. He was really helpful. Purple Alien Planet.